Australia's transcontinental railway makes one of the world's longest hauls, crossing the continent from coast to coast. So any stop is welcome, even a whistle stop at the remote railway town of Cork. Isn't long to get to know a place, but most passengers seem to think it's long enough to get to know Cook.
Well, it's something different, that's for sure.
I wouldn't like to live here.
Isolated, dry.
Yeah, not much here.
It's flat, dead. There's nothing to do, really. I just asked why you need a car, you've got nowhere to go around here. You might as well walk.
I think you'd be better off. You might as well be dead as live here. Really?
A few snap judgments, a few souvenirs, maybe a last-minute snapshot, and the tourists get back on the train. But whatever the visitor may think of Cook, the fact is that a handful of people do live out here on the Nullarbor Plain, and they see their town through quite different eyes.
Your juvenile population have got a better chance to make it into young adulthood without the pressure and without the temptation of what they've got in a lot of the cities.
We know that the kids can go out and play and not really any fear of them being hit by a car or kidnapped.
It's a funny feeling, you know, time's nothing out here, just time just goes. As I said, I've been here 6 years and that's just flown.
I sit in my old humper here, and that's it. I don't worry about nobody else. You're right, Jack, you have your say. I'm just sitting in my humper.
Cook, a tiny railway outpost, marooned like an island on a desert sea. The last place on earth most people would choose to live, but a town some 80 Australians call home. Perhaps Australia's most isolated town, Cook is set dead centre of the Nullarbor Plain, a desert barrier between Australia's east and west. Bridging the Nullarbor is the great transcontinental railway line. Barren, featureless, hot and flat and dry, the Nullarbor has never attracted settlers. The only reason anyone lives out here is to serve the railway. Building the line was a feat of human endurance in itself. The work began in 1912 in the shadow of World War I. The line opened 5 years later. The need to create the railway link meant taking men and machines into country few Europeans had ever seen before. Even Aboriginal people had never lived on the waterless Nullarbor. But the railway had to be served, so towns were built, one every 100 miles, to fuel the trains and maintain the line. The trains, in turn, supplied the towns. Today, most of these towns are being reclaimed by the desert. Compared to the old steam locomotives, modern diesels need fewer stops for fuel. In the interests of economy, even the railways have pulled back from the Nullarbor wherever they can. Cook is the last surviving town on the plain itself. Few Australian communities are so remote. It's 400 kilometres either way to Cook's nearest neighbours, the equally tiny railway towns of Tarcoola and Rawlinna. 40 trains a week come rumbling through town, but they too are always bound for somewhere else, somewhere beyond the horizon. Yet for all the isolation out here, the truth is that people in Cook see their town not as a prison, but as a haven from the cares of the outside world. And the railway itself can be counted on to bring its share of excitement to town. Veteran railway man Murray Sims remembers one particular day when all hell broke loose.
Derailment right in front of the station. First Saturday I was on duty on my own after I learned the job. Train came off the line, broken rail, and she just all piled up and speared off the line right in front of the station. Made a hell of a bloody mess.
Murray has brought up 5 children out here. He's also lived in town longer than anyone else. So he's well qualified to discuss both the best and the worst points about life in Cook.
In one respect, you can say the isolation is a fact against living in Cook. But on the other hand, you can say that the isolation is one of the benefits of living in Cook. You haven't got outside pressures, outside temptations for kids or anything like this. Pressures that shouldn't be on them, really. And in a place like this, they haven't got that pressure on them. They can live a lot freer lifestyle here than what they can in a town.
The feeling of freedom is obvious enough. The Nullarbor offers the children of Cook a very big backyard. Not many species live on the plain, but lizards do, and the after-school lizard hunt has become a daily ritual.
It's called a painted dragon. And they never shut their eyes. Lizards can grow very big.
They can grow about that big.
It's not hard to imagine tribal Aboriginal children in this same setting and immersed in exactly the same kind of hunt. These children do have other places to play. But the well-equipped playground back in town stands empty. So what are these young people like best about living in Cook?
I like the school, I like houses, and I like the shop. And I like going to school. Doing.
He likes playing ice blocks.
Yeah, and that's good fun.
I like going to school. I like everything about Cook.
As they get older, they may find that life in Cook has its limitations. But right now, at the height of a lizard hunt, there's nowhere in the world they'd rather be. First and foremost, Cook is a railway town. Train times dictate the tempo of daily life, and that can mean very early starts, particularly when the weekly store train arrives on Friday mornings. The railway gangers make an early start too, before the heat sets in. With daily temperatures ranging from freezing to searing hot, the transcontinental line has to cope with very severe extremes. So do the men who maintain the track. Compared to the old days, there are now only a handful of gangers working the Nullarbor. The line itself has been upgraded to make it more maintenance-free, And with modern equipment, teams can get to trouble spots a lot more quickly. The men can get back to town a lot faster too, and that's just as useful when the only shop for 400 kilometers has just been resupplied. Cook's one shop is a busy place come Friday mornings, usually with a queue by opening time. The railway, Australian National, runs the shop and its company policy to sell at capital city prices. It's a way of easing at least one burden of isolation. And Cook is, after all, a company town. But orders don't always get through.
This is funny, guys.
It's no fun when your cigarettes don't arrive.
When's the smoke coming?
Today, but we didn't order them. When we ordered them, we had them.
Like a bubble.
According to Annette Spackman, living in a railway town can have other drawbacks too.
You finish work and then you're socialising. There's really nothing else to talk about except for work. Some people get sick of hearing about work, and yet other people love to talk about work all the time. And that causes a few conflicts. Just because there's nothing else to talk about. You don't get newspapers a day late, so you really don't know any up-to-date news, so you might as well talk about work, because that's what it's in common. You know, you all know that train fell off the track today, and that's something in common.
Whatever the drawbacks, Annette is still an enthusiast for Cook. She's happy to challenge anyone who thinks her life might be dull.
It's a lot of people say to us, you know, what on earth do you do in Cook? And say, well, this week I've had two dinner parties at my house in 2 days. So, I mean, really, when we're in Alice Springs, we didn't do anything. It's here, we're on the go all the time. People don't believe that.
There are a few natural drawbacks to life here too, like the ferocious winds that blow more days than not.
The wind gets on people's nerves after a while. It's windy quite a bit of the time. The environment is really bad for your hair and your skin, and it's not very good for temper sometimes.
Despite the harsh climate, Annette's neighbour Sylvia Gould has quite a garden. In fact, she and her husband Merv have created a minor miracle, but it wasn't easy.
You've got to watch your north winds. Middle of summer, they're horrific some days, and just burn everything off ground level. Bar the summertime, middle of summer, you know, you get your temperatures 47 to 50 degrees. Bar about a month and a half of the year, you get beautiful growing weather, a lot of sunshine, as you can see now. You know, lettuces out of season, tomatoes, all sorts.
There's no other garden like it in Cook or anywhere on the Nullarbor. The Goulds' private oasis seems to prove the point that life anywhere can be what you make it. And for Sylvia, Cook provides another kind of oasis too.
I don't have to worry where my children are, who they're with, what they're doing, because I know my children are safe. You can't let your children outside the front door in Adelaide because they could be kidnapped. Teenagers are raped. Older people are bashed. Old age pensioners even in their homes. We don't have any of that out here. Our children are really well protected from violence. It's when they leave here, then they have to learn to be in the confines of city areas. It's out here they've got the freedom of the whole Nullarbor plan.
To city people, Sylvia's concern for her children's safety might sound a bit like paranoia. Then again, it might not.
Okay, let's go back to the top of the page, please.
I can't do this.
That's a bit harder now, I know, because you can't do it properly. B flat, F, C.
It could be a music lesson at any school in Australia, except the difference here is that the lesson is being conducted via a radio telephone link with a music teacher nearly 1,000 kilometres away.
Okay, fine. Cut, cut, cut. It won't work because we've got problems with levels now.
It's one way modern technology can help out in a place like Cook. But piano practice is hard work at the best of times, and learning this way can't make it any easier. Children make up a quarter of Cook's population, about 20 children, attending a school staffed by 4 full-time teachers.
Good morning, children.
Good morning, Mrs. Owen.
Right, well, we've been very, very lucky people. We've been camping.
For such a remote settlement, Cook's school is very well equipped.
We went to.
Students get a lot of individual attention, and lessons often combine children of very mixed ages. The atmosphere often feels more like an extended family than a formal class.
Oh, this is going to be
faster. Uh-oh, one hit the ground again.
Sayo kira itu kuching.
Lessons also make use of any special local skills. Sylvia Gould, although not a teacher, passes on her knowledge of Indonesian. Because of Cook's limited recreational outlets, teachers search constantly for new ways to extend the children's experience. As headmaster Neil Crowan explains, teaching here is more than a 9-to-5 job.
Well, I didn't know what to expect when I first arrived. I'd never been to Cook before. It's certainly been different than being a principal or a leader in another school. Out here, there's a variety of things that you have to do as principal.
Just as good as you, Mr. Crowan.
I think you have to show the community that you've got their children's needs at heart. Also think you need to show them that you're not just there for a short period of time, that you make some sort of commitment to the town by being involved in community life, and that means getting in and organising various things within the town and mixing with people and getting accepted by the people.
The recreational options for adults can be limited too. One answer to that problem is this marvel of ingenuity, a totally greenless, grass-free golf course. Cook Cemetery, by the way, is out of bounds. It may not be Royal St. Andrews, but the competition can be as stiff as the prevailing winds. And sand greens, soaked with diesel, can produce both some tricky putts and some sticky ones. To Neil, the golf course is a good example of the kind of resourcefulness people need to enjoy life in Cook.
I think you need to be able to come up with sort of strategies, I guess, that allow you to be able to cope. You need to have some interests, not necessarily worry about the things that you're used to doing, but look at the things that are available in a community like this and adapt.
Cook's unique golf course does have its advantages. Where else can you count a rabbit hole as a free drop zone? And even at weekends, you never need to shout 4 on the nullarbor.
Ahead.
Just the same, there are limitations to life out here, as the older children recognise.
The worst part about living in Cook is that there isn't enough things for kids to do, and
it's not close enough to the beach and stuff like that. Got no shopping centres.
I prefer living in the country, like Mount Gambier somewhere. I mean, then you can pick your friends and you've got more people there to get on with and that. And plus, you know, out here, schooling's good and all, but then you've got more education out in country.
Because there's nothing, no future ahead of you. You can't go out and look for a job here because most people have got them. And in a bigger town, you can go out and look or go to TAFE or whatever to get a better future.
The advantages is everyone together. And the disadvantages is there's not enough of everyone together, so.
If there are restrictions to life on the Nullarbor, there are some genuine advantages too. The plain itself hides many natural wonders, and regular excursions out of town are one way the school tries to broaden the children's experience.
We plan to do the sorts of things that the children really don't get the opportunity to do. You know, things like roller skating, ice skating, taking them to Hungry Jack's fast food places that they normally don't get an opportunity to go to, museums, to the beach. Anything that's available, we'll try and do it with the children.
This time, the children will be finding out more about their own vast backyard. An outback safari will first take them north of Cook to the edge of the Great Victoria Desert. They'll spend 3 days discovering some of the many natural secrets of the Nullarbor, and they'll end up at the head of the Great Australian Bight, the breeding ground of the southern right whale. As the children of Cook start to explore, it's soon obvious that the apparently featureless Nullarbor is in fact one endless adventure playground. This is still harsh country, where the terms of survival have always been dictated by one commodity, water. Or rather, the lack of it.
These are rock holes that the Aboriginal people would have used when they were out on the plain, and they're fairly significant to them because...
Knowing the location of precious water holes on the Nullarbor has been vital knowledge ever since Aboriginal times, and not only for human beings.
Various times of the year. You can see where animals have actually been digging. When the water gets right down low, the animals dig down further so that they can get the water. There's a couple of occasions I've been here where there's been dead dingoes curled up inside them.
Discovery is the key to this journey. Above all, the discovery that far from being barren and empty, the plain offers quite a treasure house for inquiring young minds. Nights out here can turn very cold. The children learn how to keep their camp warm, Aboriginal style, by building a windbreak out of brushwood. Tonight's camp is under shelter, a vast tin roof in the middle of nowhere, designed to trap what rain there is, a kind of man-made waterhole. As always, the young people of Cook make good use of whatever happens to be at hand. Notionally, this is a school excursion. In practice, it's very much a family affair for teachers and parents alike.
I think it's just a carry-on from what we do within the community while we're back in a place like Cook. Our responsibility doesn't end at the school gate. Going away on trips, I guess we become the parents for 2 weeks. And we treat the children as if they are our own kids.
Dr. Blake. cool, there you go. Here we go.
Next day, there's another natural wonder to explore. The Nullarbor is a vast limestone shelf, the largest of its kind in the world. The coastal side of the plain is honeycombed with caves. They are sinkholes, places where water has slowly cut its way down through the limestone, undermining the surface rock so much that a section of the plain has collapsed. Some of these underground chambers are vast. For the children, it's a chance to explore somewhere completely different. There are also reminders of how the Nullarbor was first created. Fossil remains of shells locked in the stone millions of years ago when the plain was part of the ocean floor. The caves also have important heritage value.
You can see the Aboriginal hand stencils here, which are quite common in some of these caves in the Nullarbor, and that's, I guess, a way of Aboriginal people leaving their sort of signature.
Ranger Ross Allen helps explain the caves. Although kids being kids, what Ross can tell them and what they most want to know aren't quite the same.
Excuse me?
Yeah.
How long do the dinosaurs live for?
How long do dinosaurs live for? But they lived on Earth a long time ago. An awful long time ago. Yeah, don't touch them, will you?
Ross soldiers bravely on, but so does his young questioner.
How long did the dinosaurs live in this place for?
I'm not even sure if there's any real dinosaurs here, the ones you're thinking about. But there was certainly some evidence.
This is the first time the children have been in a deep cave. Their fascination with the place, and particularly with its wildlife, is pretty obvious. Young Robbie, at least, could well be another David Attenborough in the making. But it's the cave itself that intrigues the children most. It's a mysterious place, and it becomes much more so when Neil suggests everyone turns their torches off. The lights don't stay off for long. The children of the Nullarbor are used to fresh air and open spaces. The utter darkness of the deep cave is a new experience and maybe just a bit scary. Back to fresh air. And with just time to dust off and to get ready for another special highlight of the trip. The head of the Bight lies almost due south of Cook. It's a spectacular stretch of coast. The sea has carved out sheer limestone cliffs as it slowly claims back the plain it created so long ago. These Nullarbor cliffs run almost unbroken for 2,000 kilometres, a formidable barrier between the sea and the land. But the head of the Bight has a further attraction. It's a breeding ground for the southern right whale and one of the best places on Earth to see the whales close up. Both the chopper ride and the view of the whales make quite an impression.
It's lovely. Coast is beautiful. You see some whales?
Yeah.
Yeah, it was good.
They're called southern right whales, and they really are quite threatened. in numbers now because of the whaling that went on in the early days, especially on the Australian coast and South Australian coast.
Once again, National Parks Ranger Ross is the children's guide.
There was a lot more of the whales in the waters generally here, and they were exploited very heavily. Because they're in nice and close and they stay on the surface and they don't sink when you kill them, which a lot of the other species did, that's where they got their name from. They were the right whale to go and hunt.
Ross explains that it's the right whale's considerable blubber that keeps it afloat, which prompts the children to ask another question.
The size? Yeah, well, they're pretty big, aren't they? people describe them about the size of a bus, because they're about 40 foot long or about 18 metres long, the biggest ones, and they weigh up to about 90 tonnes. And they're very beamy, very wide in the body, and they put on weight very quickly, anything up to about 40 kilos a day.
The children are certainly interested in the whales, but they are still desert children, and this is the beach. It's worth mentioning that it's a bleak midwinter day. The beach-starved children of Cook couldn't care less. Try as the whales might, in the final contest for the children's attention, it's Whales 5 surfing 10. Another early morning in Cook, and yet another early start for the town. Most of the population is boarding a red-eye special bound for Tarcoola because it's the day of the long-awaited inter-school sports. For the railway men left in town, it seems like the start of a more typical day. A change crew boards a waiting freighter, and station supervisor Merv Gould sets out on his rounds. It's Merv's job to keep the trains running on time, which might sound routine, but out here you never quite know what the day holds in store.
Thanks, Merv.
When you're ready.
Right, yeah.
No worries. Okay, see ya.
Yeah.
By the end of this day, Merv will have run a race of his own, as tough as any event at the inter-school sports. The trouble starts the minute he gets back to his office.
Right, I'll try and chase them up. Where's the truck, Murray?
About 3 feet from the logo.
The problem is simply stated, if hard to solve. Merv has two freight trains in town and two Indian Pacific passenger trains approaching, one from each way. But the main line is blocked because train inspector Murray Sims has just found a faulty coupling on one of the freighters. To get the train moving, it will have to be fixed.
Well, I want at least one high jack to get right up underneath it to lift it up, and I want two new bolts.
Righto, we'll need the fitters, will we, for the jacks?
Well, I don't know what sort of jacks they've got.
They've
got a high jack there. That'll be handy.
Right, I'll try and chase them up.
So far, so good. But Merv has just learned of another problem, too. A diabetic traveller on one of the stranded passenger trains is in urgent need of an insulin shot.
Yeah, Merv here at the station, Christina. Can you meet the passenger here about another half hour's time, please, going to Adelaide? There's a lady, a diabetic, on there, needs some medication, apparently. Okay. Okay. See ya.
P3's already left and SP5 is...
Good day, Murph.
Oh, yeah.
For our travellers from Cook, bound for Tarcoola, the train journey is just another routine trip. Yet railway enthusiasts come from around the world to travel on this same stretch of track, the longest straight length of railway on Earth, 400 kilometres without a curve. Organising Tarcoola's Sports Day is no small feat. It means bringing together teams divided by 1,000 kilometres of railway line. But the inter-school sports has become an annual tradition. Teams from the three transcontinental railway towns, Rawlinna, Tarcoola and Cook, will fight it out for local pride. Merv and Murray are chasing a result too.
Well, you reckon I'll be safe to go back in the water?
Yeah.
Okay.
Their event is harder. Cook isn't really equipped for major repairs to rolling stock. This is one of those times when Cook is glad to have, if not a doctor, then at least a well-equipped bush hospital with its resident nurse.
Sister Christina Ryman,
yeah,
from the hospital.
Yeah.
It's a social get-together as much as a sports day. In some of the novelty events, the competition seems less important than just having fun. Dads and toddlers even get involved. But some events are more serious, with passions running high.
Train control to Cook Station, you there, Merv?
Yeah, receiving, John.
Merv's race, however, is developing the character of a marathon. The faulty freight car can't be fixed.
Yeah, righto, John. I'll go and detach it and I'll get back to you.
You've never learned how to give them yourself.
Yeah, I do, but I get a bubble. I can't do it. I'll get it.
Yeah. And they just do it under the skin, do they?
Yeah.
Right. Here we are.
You there, driver of PA8?
Yes, Mervyn, receiving.
Lindsay, where are you sitting?
Been here for about 10 minutes.
Right, you'll be there for another 20 minutes here too, so sit there quietly.
To make way for the passenger trains, the freighter has to be shunted off the track.
We'll take it off and put on the triangle.
Meanwhile, the actual marathon is also underway. Cook has three favoured runners, Matthew, Pete, and at least one heavyweight prospect, Headmaster Neil. Finally, both marathons produce a top result for Cook, with places going to Merv, to Pete, to Neil, and to Matthew, who, if he doesn't quite match the physical stature of the others yet, is at least their equal when it comes to effort. Cook has high hopes in the high jump, too. With the bar getting higher, it's psyching out time. What most people don't know is that Pete chipped his elbow while practicing for this event. Further injury will involve his mother in a 12-hour round trip to the nearest specialised medical service. Unable to talk him out of jumping, she's not game to watch. Pete's a popular winner, and no one's more relieved to see him come through unscathed than his mum.
I stayed here. I wasn't going around there. If he broke his arm, I was going to break a few necks.
Oh, get Nick!
The one good thing about a bad day is how glad you feel when it's over. With his trains finally back on track, Merv has one last message for train control.
No worries.
Sports day isn't quite over. There's still the dog spiking, an event for adults, you'll notice, and one where the railway towns of the Nullarbor should really shine. The idea here is to, well, you can see for yourself. Cooks Joe Baker and his mate Rodney Tucker set a record time.
Yeah. Oh, now I know what it's like to win gold at the Olympics. Must be unreal, eh? Oh, it's good, though.
Them jiggers get you working.
Yes, it is competition, but it's a social occasion too.
And the winner of the handicap competition today was Cook.
And while winning matters, the really important thing is to have taken part. A stifling dust storm and howling winds. It's a fairly typical day on the Nullarbor. It's also Christmas. There's no snow, no mistletoe, and not a Christmas tree in sight. But a very traditional visitor is on his way. Santa Claus has been coming to town as long as there have been railway settlements on the Nullarbor. Santa travels minus reindeer and by train, but that's only what Nullarbor children would expect. This is a part of the world where most good things come by rail. Thirty years ago, Santa would have made half a dozen stops along the track. Today, when so many of the old Nullarbor settlements have vanished, Santa's stops are fewer and further apart. But the welcome he gets from these isolated children is as warm as it ever was. For the children of Cook, it's a welcome break from routine. One day in the year when they can feel just a bit less remote.
I saw you last year, didn't I?
And Philip.
And Philip, yeah, I saw Philip.
Come on, down here to Mum.
There we are, Justin. That's a good boy.
Down here and talk.
It's not just a matter of getting presents. The gifts are important, but so is the direct contact with a traditional Christmas figure. One who these isolated children would otherwise only know from Christmas cards.
Christy Tucker.
Christy's not here today. Yes. I know you are, darling.
Naturally, Santa can't travel without his helpers. And whenever this Santa visits the Nullarbor, retired railway man Alf Harris is never far away.
Merry Christmas, Jenny. You got a kiss, haven't you? Good girl. There you are. I saw your dad down the track. There you are.
No.
You got a kiss? Don't be shy. That's a girl.
Alf Harris knows just what isolation can mean for the people who live out here all year round. Like Santa, he's been making this trip for 32 years. He assures us that every kilometre of the journey is a labour of love.
Oh!
The end of this year brings another social gathering too. It may not be a million-dollar display, but it's quite enough to capture the children's rapt attention. This gathering has another special purpose. Most of the town here is to farewell two popular figures in Cook, Headmaster Neil Crowan and his wife. In fact, farewells are a pretty regular feature of life in Cook.
But the community have put their thanks together and bought a little thing for you. We'd like you to step up and accept it as a community. It's not much, it's probably a free beer, actually. But I'd just like to say thanks for your cooperation as a friend, as a school teacher, as a patron of Cook, and the best of luck wherever you go.
Thank you.
Thank you. And we'd like you to accept that over there in the corner. And say a few words.
Well, I get it, because
I'm moving. I'm not going to say much. Because I can't, you'd see a grown person cry, I think. all I'd like to say is I've really enjoyed my 5 years here. You know, we always go out of town and people say, you know, Cook, what the hell do you do out there?
In the end, Cook is a transit town with a temporary population. People may stay for months or years. They may learn to love the isolation or just to live with it. But finally, they move on like the trains they serve. But there is at least one notable exception.
You there, Henry?
Railway man Henry Cox is Cook's only private homeowner. He's also the first person ever to decide to retire in Cook. So it seems fitting to give Henry the very last word.
We're bush bred, and that's it. We just love it. Otherwise, we've got to go bush again. Look around. Well, you've got everything here at the end. You've got your post office, you've got your railway station, you've got your shop, you've got your school, you've got your hospital. What more you want? Nothing, eh? Anything else you want to know about Cook?